Hello, my name is Marian Petrov and I'm Grandmaster from Bulgaria. Welcome to this course, which is dedicated to the King's Indian Defense. And I would like to show you how to play with black in King's Indian Defense. And I will try to show you all the possible main lines for white, as well as some other ways which usually white use to avoid the King's Indian Defense, so you're going to be prepared everywhere. Today in this first chapter we're going to see two of the possible ways for white to avoid the King's Indian. This is after the move d4, knight f6. And now first we're going to see when white are playing the move bishop g5. This opening is called Trompowsky. And actually with this move bishop g5, white are avoiding not only King's Indian, but they're avoiding almost all the possible openings. For example, it's not possible to play now Grünfeld or Benoni on Imsu Indian. So this move bishop g5 is not so bad at all. And here black have more limited options comparing to the other moves like c4 and knight f3. Because now they have to pay attention to this move, which wants maybe to take their knight and double their pawns. And in general the reason for this move is also for the other move which we're going to see, bishop f4. Is that many of the white players don't want to go into complications, and they have seen a lot of games in King's Indian in which black are just pushing the pawns towards their king, and they don't want to go into these kind of positions. So this line is bishop g5 and bishop f4. White are going to receive a more simple position, not so complicated, and most importantly, maybe they prefer that the king has to be safe in most of these cases. Actually, the main idea behind the bishop g5 is maybe not necessarily to take the knight on f6, although of course many people would take it, but the idea is just to play after this the move e3, and of course white prefer to develop first the bishop, and also white are delaying the move c4, and maybe even they will not play it at all, this move c4. So they prefer to receive some kind of positions with e3, knight f3, maybe even c3, knight d2, something like a queen's gambit, but with a tempo more, which tempo is the move exactly bishop g5, because maybe you know, most of you, that in a queen's gambit usually the black bishop is on c8 for a long time, so this will be a big improvement if you can develop this bishop. Although there are some also some sharp lines in which white are taking on f6, if black allow this, and then they are trying to play even e4. So what to do now? Here there are many good moves for black. It depends from your style. You can play, for instance, the move g6. If you want to play King's Indian, you have to be, of course, familiar with all these setups. And now this move allows white to take on f6. Of course, they can take it on f6, and now black can take with the pawn. And what is typical for this pawn structure when you have a double pawns? First of all, for instance, now if white played the active move e4, this will give you a chance at some moment later in the game maybe to play at some point the move f5. Let's say you play now bishop g7, knight f3, d6, knight c3. Now you can play f5 immediately or after the castle. Let's say if white played the move like bishop c4 or bishop e2. And with the move f5, you're going to trade your double pawns, and then you're going to receive the positional pair of bishops, which in general is good for you. That's why many people here with white, they don't play the move e4, so they prefer to play the move e3, not to allow with this move to trade their pawn, and then they play c4, knight c3, knight f3. In this case, you can play again the move f5, and then the idea is to bring this knight to a good square, and the best possible square for the knight is square e4, so you can start with this move. Now white can play c4, let's say, something like this. And this knight is going to d7, and then, potentially, he can go to f6, and he wants to jump to, at some point, to e4. Now you can play rook e8, queen to e7 to support in case you need more hits, and then finally, the knight will go to e4, and again, I think black have a good position in this line. Maybe the one thing you have to be careful is in this kind of position after e4, not to play a move like d5, let's say, Not that its move is losing something, but in general, if you have this pawn structure, now imagine that you trade all the pieces, and then it's a pawn endgame. In the pawn endgame, white will win this because you have these double pawns here on the f-file, which will be stopped by the single f-pawn. So the d-pawn will be look like an extra pawn in the pawn endgame. Of course, the endgame is far away, and black still have good chances, but in general, this is something which you have to be careful about the possible endgame when you have double pawns. For example, in this position, if white played the move e5, now this endgame is completely different because the pawn from d4 has moved to e5, and the f-pawn could stop the pawn, and or you can trade the pawn with f6, or you can simply play bishop e6, and in case of white takes, again, the f-pawn will stop the e5 pawn. So this some small details about the structures in this possible line. Another possible setup here for black is, if you don't want to play g6, to play e6. This way, in case of white takes on f6, you can take with the queen. But you have to be ready for a move e4 immediately. And now you have to play h6 or bishop h7, but bishop e7, white simply will push the pawn to e5, and then after knight d5, they can play c4, so you're going to lose a lot of moves with the knight. It will be something like Alekhine defense. That's why usually black here playing the move h6, taking advantage that bishop h4 is not a good move, because after g5, white will win the central pawn, which means that after h6, white has to take on f6, and now black takes with the queen. So this is also one very interesting plan, in which black are having the pair of bishops, but white are having for the moment better center. So the question is, which is going to be more important, the center or the pair of bishops? And in general, this is a very complicated position. Usually white are playing knight c3, and now black are playing the move d6. After this, sometimes even the queen goes back to d8, and black just try to develop as quickly as they possible with bishop e7, castle knight d7, and then later they push the pawn to e5. So this is one of the typical plans in this position. Also here, after e6, of course, white can prefer not to play e4, but they can play e3, so then the things can revert to a normal queen's gambit if you play d5. But this line in general is good for black. So this is the other possibility for white. Another good line against bishop g5 is simply to play the move d5. And now again, this moves gives white two options to take the knight. Here usually people take with the e-pawn, although if you're adventurous, you can try the g-pawn. But this is more simple, e takes. And what is the plan here? Again, the plan is very similar, to bring this knight on e4, so in case of knight f3, of course you can put the bishop on f5 if you want, or bishop g4, but if you simply play, for instance, again this setup, let's say bishop d3, f5, castle, here you need to play now the move g6 to defend the pawn if you want to bring the knight, and after c4, you can play c6, although it will create a weak pawn on d5. For instance, after knight c3, you have to play bishop e6, and then you can bring the knight to f6 and to e4, but you have to be careful for some queen b3 ideas. Or you can simply take on c4, and then play knight d7, and then again the knight will go eventually to f6, and on e4 you can play c6 and bishop e6 also. So the ideas are quite similar with the previous example. Another possible move after bishop g5 is the move c5, which again gives a chance to white to take on f6 if they want, but here, if they take on f6, you have to take with the g-pawn, because if you take with the e-pawn, after this pawn is traded for the d-pawn, the pawn on d7 will be very weak, and even if you manage to play d5, it is going to be isolated pawn, which will be not so easy to defend. That's why here, after bishop takes, black usually take with the g-pawn. So now, if you trade this pawn, the d-pawn will be supported from the e-pawn. And in general, this is good for black because the pawn is going towards the center. So they're going to have one extra pawn in the center. It also opens the g file for the rook, but it's not very often in this line in which black are attacking on the g file. When you take on the f6 with the pawn, usually it means that you cannot castle kingside, because the king is very exposed, but actually here there are a lot of games in which black simply play bishop g7 and then castle, and their king actually feels quite safe, so you don't have to worry. What can white do here after this move? Usually they can play c3 or e3 or d5. d5 is maybe the most popular move, and now the queen can go to b6. Again, taking advantage that the bishop is not on c1, so now white has to defend somehow this pawn. And b3 is usually not a good idea, because after f5 you can bring the bishop to g7. From the other hand, queen c1 looks a bit passive. So this is also, I think, a good line for black. Here also you can play a move like f5, and then you can bring the bishop to g7. And white has to defend this pawn, let's say with c3. And here there are many possible moves. Maybe even e5 is an option, but just d6, and then you play knight d7, knight f6 again. Or you can move the queen back and try to play b5. There are a lot of good ideas here for black. And finally, we have to see the most critical line, which is after bishop g5. Of course, this is the move knight e4, immediately attacking the bishop. And now white has to move again the bishop. So it seems that the bishop g5 move was not a very good idea, because now only after 3 moves white has to play a second move with the bishop. But actually there is an idea, of course, in this move. And let's see now first if white play bishop h4. Here there is one very funny line, actually, in which black are playing the move g5. This is one of the most popular moves, g5, attacking the bishop. And white has to go bishop g3. But then you can play a move like bishop g7, let's say, and at some moment black wants to trade on g3, let's say after f3, knight takes, h takes. And now black can play c5, for example, queen b6, and they have a good position. That's why, actually, after the move g5, the main line goes f3 immediately. So white don't want to allow this knight g3 idea, and even if they cannot avoid trading of the bishop for the knight, they prefer to do it this way, because it brings the g pawn to the h4, so now black have these two edge pawns, and also the pawn now from f3 is moving towards the center, so it can give potentially maybe white some advantage in the center. And now there are many possible moves here. The position is very complicated. Black have, of course, a pair of bishops, and the white king is a bit exposed. So in general, this is a very risky line for white. Here black usually playing the move c5, which is very typical, especially when there is no bishop on c1 to attack this pawn. And here it will be a big mistake for white to play the move d5, because after bishop g7, the bishop is taking control over this whole diagonal, and also black have a square e5, potentially for the knight they can play d6, knight d7, knight e5. That's why white are defending the pawn with e3. And now even there is a move bishop h6 to attack this pawn. And here for white it's actually difficult to defend the pawn with the queen, because if you play queen d2, and now black take here, and now white are forced to take with the queen, which leaves these two pawns in the center, they are going to be very weak and exposed. And here the main move is king f2, and now black can play queen b6, and it's a very complicated position, but I think in general it should be good for black, because the white king is in the center, and I don't think that they can play here for advantage. So this is one very interesting line. The other possible moves after the move knight e4, bishop f4, and even there is a move h4, but I don't think this move h4 is too good, because black have many good moves like d5 and c5, and h4 is not a move which can bring some pressure. It's not developing any piece, so in general I don't think it's very good. But the move bishop f4 is also possible. What is the difference comparing to the bishop h4? And now, of course, the difference is that black can push e6 if they want, because there is no pin. But apart from the move e6, also there are other moves like d5 and c5 in general, when you can push the pawn to d5 and c5. This is most of the time a good idea. Here, what was the purpose of this bishop g5 f4 idea? The main reason is that when the knight is on e4, it seems that this is good for black, because in general it's always good to activate your knight in the center, but white are hoping that, let's say, with the move knight d2, they can now first of all attack the knight, and if black takes on d2, now queen d2, and suddenly white have two pieces which are developed and black don't have any. So this is one of the ideas, and the other idea is if black play move like e6 or something like this, they want to take on e4 and double the black pawns. But of course black can simply play even here bishop f5, and in case of knight f3 e6, and again they are going to receive a very good position. I think this also is completely equal this position, so even d5 I think is a good option. But if you want to play something sharper, you can try the move c5. Again, now the idea is in case of d5 to play queen b6 and to attack this pawn. Here, for example, b3 will be a big mistake, because now queen f6 will attack the bishop, also checkmate, and also the rook. That's why after queen b6, black have a good chances. White has to be careful. And sometimes even they defend this pawn with the queen c1, or even the bishop can go to c1. Here after c5, of course, in case of e3, you again play queen b6. There is an additional move here for white, which is the move f3. And now you can go either knight f6, either you can play queen f5 check. What is the purpose of queen f5 check? Of course, after knight d2 to trade the knights immediately, but if white played c3, then they cannot play knight c3 so easy. So now you go knight f6, and actually, maybe queen f5 is of course not the best square for the queen, but also the pawn on c3 gives white less chances. And now, for instance, after d5, e6, they cannot play c4 and knight c3 immediately. So they have to play something like this, and then here after d6, for example, also I think black have good chances in this line. Here we can only highlight that with these pawns on c3 and f3, the white knights doesn't have good squares at all, so it should be good for black in general. And I think with this last move knight e4, we are concluding most of the good replies after bishop g5, and we can see now some examples. But before to do this, I would like to show you another possible route for white to avoid King's Indian. This is to play so-called London system with a move bishop f4. Another possible, by the way, deviation of Trompowsky is after knight f3 to play now bishop g5. But this is actually better for you if you want to play King's Indian, which you want, because now you can play bishop g7, and now bishop f6 is not so good now, because you can simply take with the bishop. And if they play e3 or c3, this is okay for you. It's not dangerous at all. Sometimes here white are playing the move knight d2, with which they want to play e4. And here even you can play castle, because this variation of perk is not dangerous at all. After d6, this line is okay for black. But if you want to stop e4, you can play the move d5 immediately. And now white will be forced to play e3. And then also I think this position is quite good for black. After bishop e2, they have many good moves. For instance, you can play c5 and then knight c6, and I don't see any problems here for black. So now let's switch to the London system. This can start with the move bishop f4, but also it can start with the move knight f3. So sometimes it can just transpose, and usually white wants to receive this position, knight f3, bishop f4, and then to play e3. What is the purpose of this bishop f4 line? What do white wants? In general, they want the same thing like with bishop g5, to avoid openings like King's Indian or Grünfeld or Benoni or many sharp openings, and they want to receive a solid position, something like a Queen's Gambit setup, but with a bishop on f4 as a tempo more. And what can black do here? Let's say you castle. And in this line, when white are delaying the move c4, usually they don't play c4, they can play even the pawn to c3, because they want to bring their knight to d2, but they can start with the move bishop e2. This is a setup for white which can be played against all the possible openings, not only against King's Indian, but white can play these moves against Queen's Gambit, Nimtz Indian setup. On every setup they can play d4, knight f3, bishop f4. So that's why many people like this, because it's simple and there is no need for big preparation. In general, what should we watch out here? It would be good if you can play most of the cases knight h5 and try this bishop. But for instance, after castle now, sorry here, if you play immediately knight h5, white can play the move bishop e5 and force the move f6. So then it will be not so good for you to play f5 in this position immediately. That's why usually black wants to prepare the move knight h5, and here they play first the move d6. And after castle, then you can play already the move knight h5, because now bishop e5 is not good. And if white wants to avoid this bishop to be traded, they can play bishop g5, but now you can play h6, bishop h4, and to play here the move g5. So in this kind of positions, usually if white play bishop g3, this is okay for you. Here even you can play, I think, the move f5, and for white it's not good to play h3, because after you take on g3 and they take with the f pawn, this pawn could be a bit exposed later, e3 and g3. So many players here, after the move g5, instead of bishop g3, they prefer to play the move knight d2 to attack the bishop on h5. And in case of pawn takes, white wants to take on h5, and at least in exchange for the bishop which was traded, black have these pawns on h6 and h4. And here white will try maybe to eventually to have a better middle game with this a little bit better pawn structure. Many white players, in order to avoid these complications with g5 and knight h5, here in this position after the move d6, they are playing immediately the move h3, and the main idea of this move is to meet knight h5 with bishop h2. So then the bishop on h2 will be equally good as on f4, but the knight on h5 will be not so good, and most likely you have to play the knight back to f6. And this is one of the key moves for white in the London system, the move h3, not to stop the bishop g4 or knight g4, but to stop knight h5 and to prepare a retreat for the bishop to h2. So what to do here with black? There are actually many good plans. You can simply play a move like b6, let's say, and after castle to play bishop b7. So this way we're going to fianchetto both of the bishops, and usually again white are playing the move c3. And now you can play the move c5, and let's say after knight d2, it's time to develop the last piece, the knight, and the knight on c6 will be blocking the bishop on b7, so that's why you have to play knight d7. Now most of the people play bishop h2 to avoid some kind of quick e5, e4 moves, and here the plan for black is usually they put the queen on c7, white are playing usually a4 with the e a5, and many people play the move a6, so they can meet a5 with b5, and then they put the rooks on c8, on e8, they can try to play knight d5 or e5, depends on the situation. And this is a very complicated position. The evaluation is that it's equal, but both sides have their chances. So this is one of the ways. The other way is a little bit more King's Indian. This is where black wants to prepare the move e5. And the most natural is to play this knight from b to d7, and after castle to try to play a move like rook e8. But actually it's not preparing the move e5, because Imagine that white are playing c3 or c4, it's not important. e5 is losing a pawn after pawn takes, knight takes e5, because in the end of the line, white takes the queen, and after rook takes, they take with the bishop, and you have lost your central pawn. That's why if you want to play knight d7 after castle, you have to play queen to e8, but after bishop h2 e5, at some moment this queen has to go to e7, and this is quite also okay for black, but this time black are playing queen 8, queen 7, so this is a loss of time. So here there is a very clever other way to play the move e5, which is the move knight f to d7, which looks a little bit strange because it blocks the bishop and closes all the other pieces. But important thing is that now immediately you want to play e5 because you have already enough hits. And this combination in the end, like it was the other case, knight takes e5, is not working. And now if white plays castle, usually black plays e5, bishop h2. Here in this kind of positions, usually white don't take on e5 because they can lose very quickly. For instance, after bishop h2, e4 is attacking the knight and attacking on b2. And after knight d4, black can also play c5, and white are going to lose here something. That's why after the move e5 they go back with the bishop. And now also another important move is the move f5. Black are taking advantage that the knight went to d7, so now they have two pawns in the center. And if white plays c3, you can develop knight, now the other knight to c6. And I think this is also a good position for black, very active. You have two pawns in the center, white pieces are not so active. And after knight d2, black can play many good moves. They can prepare e4, or they can play queen 7. Even maybe they can prepare some g5 ideas. So this is a quite promising position for black. Another possible setup here for black is to play c5 immediately. And again with this idea, queen b6, in case of bishop e2, you can play queen b6 to attack the pawn. And as usual, b3 is not so good because of knight d5. And if they play queen c1, you can play, for example, d5, knight c6, bishop f5 or bishop g4. And also, I think this is a quite good position for black. I don't see any problem for them. And our first example will be a game between Michael Adams and the former world champion Anatoly Karpov, which was played back in 1994. And here Michael Adams is trying this Trompowsky line, and Karpov is replying with the move e6. At this time Karpov was playing mainly Queen's Gambit, so he wants to receive this setup with d5. But now white playing the move e4, which we have seen in some of the lines. Here we already know that black has to play the move h6. And now white has to take on f6, otherwise they will lose the central pawn. And after queen takes, white are playing the move knight c3. Here black are playing the move d6. And in general, usually when you have two bishops, and for example, your opponent has lost his dark square bishop, like in this case, you are trying to put your pawns on dark squares, because this way you can take advantage of the loss of his bishop. That's why black are playing the pawn to d6, and they are not playing, for instance, c6 and d5 to put the pawn on light squares. Now queen d2 was played, and the idea of queen d2 is of course maybe to castle queen side, but also maybe white wants to play the pawn to f4, and if they can play f4, they will get a very good center. So Anatoly Karpov replied with the move g5, which is very double-edged, of course. Most of the time, if you play h6 and g5 in the opening after the 6th move, it will be very bad. But here, in this position, it's not so bad if a player like Anatoly Karpov is making this move. And his main purpose is, like I told you, to push g5 to stop the move f4, and also to play the move bishop g7, and then try to attack the pawn on d4. Then you can meet the knight f3, maybe even with the g4. So this is a very active move, and it's showing that Karpov was ready for a fight in this game. So castle was made, and so do bishop g7. And now it's time for white to find some good plan. And here there is no use to play the knight on f3, because black can play pawn to g4 and the knight has to go back. The knight e2 will lose the f2 pawn. So that's why white has to try to find something else. The move f3 looks like a waste of time a bit. So it's not so good. Maybe they can try g3, bishop g2, but then again, after, for example, knight c6, you have to do something with this pawn. And it's not a good idea to play the move d5, because it will open the big diagonal for the queen and the bishop. But here Adams has found an interesting reply, which is a move e5. This is also a very sharp move, and it shows also that he was ready to fight, so this game becomes now a real battle. Now Karpov took on e5, and pawn takes, and now of course not queen e5, because queen d8 checkmate will be very embarrassing. But the queen has to go to e7. So with this trade, d takes e5, Karpov has created maybe a weak pawn on e5, and he is defending the d8 square. Now white has to play the move f4 in order to defend the pawn. And black are playing the move knight c6. They don't want to take on f4, because after queen takes, the white queen will actually be very active on f4, and after knight f3, she will defend the e5 square, and she can support the move knight e4 and knight f6 check. So black don't need this queen to be on f4. Knight c6 was played, and now Adams is playing the move knight f3. He wants to, again, to provoke either g4, either pawn to take f4, because, like I told you already, it would be good for white if black takes on f4. But if, for instance, black play g4, it's also not so bad for white, because they can play knight to d4. And then again, this pawn is defended very well. There is no pressure. And now this bishop is closed on the diagonal. So at some moment, this knight will go to e4, and white are going to have very good position. That's why maybe Anatoly Karpov decided not to take or play g4. So for the moment, he is developing his pieces, and he is playing the move bishop d7. Here also black has to decide, of course, where to castle. And of course, when you play h6 and g5, it will be extremely risky to castle kingside. So with this move bishop d7, Karpov is preparing the queenside castle. And he is not afraid to lose the pawn on g5, because in case of pawn takes, queen g5 is going to be met with the move bishop h6. And suddenly the queen will be lost, because she is on the same diagonal as the king. That's why after the move bishop d7, Adams wanted to, again, maybe a little bit to force too much Karpov to do something. And he made the move h4, because he finally wanted to clarify the situation and make black either take on f4, either to play g4. Now castle is not so good, because after pawn takes, rook takes h8, white can simply take with the knight on g5, and then they're going to have extra pawn. So black has to take some decision. And here Karpov decided that maybe it would be better to take on f4, because after g4, the king side is closed, but white can play the move g3, which will defend all their pawns, and this bishop on g7 maybe will be not so good. So with the taken on f4, he wants to again continue to make this pawn on e5 a bit exposed, although for the moment she is well defended, but in general for the end game she could be a potential target. So here the question after castle is if this pawn is weak on e5, or she is strong because she is blocking the bishop. And now white are playing the move knight e4, and it seems that actually this pawn is quite strong, because now black a little bit run out of moves. They don't have a useful moves with their bishops, or their queen also, and with their knight. So they can only maybe move the rooks. So maybe with this position, Michael Adams was thinking that he has a very good game, and maybe he was quite happy with the outcome of the opening. Now with this move, of course, knight e4 White wants to exploit the weakness of the square f6. Maybe even the knight can jump to f6 at some moment, although white has to be careful for some tricks like knight takes e5 and bishop f6. But the white plan looks very simple. They want to move the bishop to b5 or to c4, and then just to double the rooks on the d-file, and it's very difficult to see what exactly black can play. If here black tries to play a move like h5, this will also give the g5 square for the other knight. So here this knight can go to g5 and to attack the pawn on f7. And potentially for the endgame the pawn on h5 could be weak, because white can play bishop e2, knight g3 and try to attack this pawn, and she can be defended only with the rook on h8. But if you stay with the rook on h8, he will be also passive. But here in this position, suddenly, Karpov has found a very interesting move, which is the move knight to b8. Okay, this move, I'm sure that it came as a big surprise to Adams. What is the purpose of this move? What do black want? And why this move is so good? Actually, this move is good because now it solves the problem of this bishop on d7, which was very passive, and he couldn't go only to e8, but this will break the communication between the black rooks. So now simply black wants to play on the next move, the move bishop c6. And suddenly the bishop will come on this big diagonal, and then he can be traded for one of the knights. And the knight can go to d7, and again he's going to attack the pawn on e5 now. But the bishop will be much stronger on c6 comparing to his position on d7. So this is the main goal, to play bishop c6, then maybe trade a couple of the rooks and play knight d7. And what can white do here? Most probably they have to develop the bishop somewhere. They have to play bishop b2 or bishop c4. In the game, Adams decided to play bishop e2. And now, of course, Karpov has played the move bishop c6. And now already he wants to play the knight d7, which not only attack the e5 square, but it will defend the f6 square, so the move knight f6 will be not possible anymore. And here Adams probably could have played a lot of moves. In the end he decided to jump immediately on f6. But maybe, like I told you, he was afraid that after knight d7 it will be not possible. And also maybe he thought that black can take the knight on e4. And then when he takes with the queen, actually he will lose all his potential advantage, because the other knight on f3 has to defend the pawn on e5 all the time. And with the bishop on e2, white cannot create a lot of things. So that's why he went knight f6. But now, after knight d7, actually it's already okay for black, because now they are going to trade this knight, which was very dangerous. And now most probably white should have taken d7, but it means that all these moves knight e4, knight f6 were for nothing if you were forced to take on d7. And here Adams decided to go into some complications. He played the move knight h4, which is very double-edged. Of course the idea of this move is to attack the bishop, and if, for example, black play rook g8, white can simply take on g7 and then take on h6. If black plays bishop f8, of course this will be a very passive move, which leaves only with one possible move for black. This is the move bishop f3, and this was the move probably which Adams calculated. Now white has to take on f3 with the bishop. Still the bishop on g7 is attacked. Now white are losing their central pawn, but they are relying their hopes on the move queen e4. And now there are two threats. Of course queen b7 is a big threat, so you cannot play knight c5 also, because you lose the bishop. But of course black can play the move c6. And now why it was this pawn sacrifice? What was the reason for this move knight h5? Of course Adams saw this possible defense bishop e5 and c6, but after here c6, white have this elegant hit rook takes d7, which maybe Adams thought that is very strong for him. And the idea of this move, of course, is to take the bishop on e5, That's why Karpov decided to take another pawn for this bishop, bishop b2, king b2, and rook d7. So maybe Adams overestimated a little bit this combination, because now white has two pieces, the bishop and the knight, and black has rook and two pawns. But in general, in the endgame, the rook and two pawns are sometimes stronger than the bishop and the knight. Of course, it depends a lot if the bishop and the knight have a good coordination, what is the pawn structure. But in this position, I think the knight especially is not so good on h5. And the bishop has this diagonal, but the pawn on c6 is blocking his diagonal, so he cannot do also a lot of things. So in general, black have good chances here. Now white are playing the move queen e3, which attack both pawns on a7 and h6, and of course now king b8 is not possible because queen e5 check, and you're going to lose the rook. And if you play b6, you're going to lose the c6 pawn. And in case of a6, maybe white can play queen a7. So this will be a good position for the queen, but here Karpov has found a very good reply. The move rook d8. He sacrificed both pawns, but most importantly, he wants to take control over the d-file with both rooks, and they can go now to d4 or d2. For instance, now queen a7 is not so good, because after queen b4, now the white king is in big danger. And that's why Adams decided to stop this possible check from b4, and he played the move a3. And he is keeping his threats, so he still attacks both pawns. But now after a3, Karpov is playing the move rook d4. So this way he is defending the a7 pawn, and he is attacking the h4 pawn. In case of queen h6, probably he can just take rook takes h4. And now slowly from this position, black are starting to improve their pieces. White decided to play g3 to defend the h-pawn. But now Karpov is activating his queen on c5. Meanwhile, threatening the move rook b4 check, and then the queen is hanging. That's why if white wants to keep the queen on this position, they have to play the move rook e1 to defend the queen. And now Karpov decided that it's a good idea to trade the queens if he can, because he don't have any weaknesses, all his pawns are defended, and he is hoping that with rooks he can try to attack the maybe the g3 pawn or the c2 pawn. He can play rook d2 at some moment, and he wanted to simplify the position, and actually white cannot do too much about it. So Adams decided to trade the queens. Now after rook takes c5, like I said, the threat is rook d2. That's why maybe white are playing the move rook e2. So for the moment white is defending everything, and it's not so clear how exactly black can win this, because the pawn on g3 is defended, all the other pawns are defended. Now the move rook e2 gives black rook chance to go to d1, and then now the rook becomes very active, because there are a lot of threats. For example, rook b5 check could be played, to the rook can go to g1 if the knight moves. Knight 4 was played, and now rook b5 check. Adams decided to go to a2 with this rook, because otherwise after king c3, black could have played here rook a1, and then they will take the a3 pawn, so he has to stay here and defend the a pawn. Now the rook goes to b1, and again Karpov wants to play rook a1, rook b1 check, and again win the a3 pawn. And actually it's very difficult to defend this pawn. Adam decided to seek some complications. He played bishop h5 to attack the f7 pawn. So here black have to actually calculate very precisely what's going on, because they can lose both pawns on f7 and e6. Rook a1 check was played, and now again check. And now king c3 of course is losing both pawns with check after rook takes a3 and rook takes g3. That's why white has to go to c4, but still rook a3 is attacking the g3 pawn. Now after bishop takes, rook takes, bishop e6 check. In the end White managed to take both black pawns on f and e in exchange for their two pawns, so the position simplifies a little bit. But now after king c7, suddenly the white king is in a little bit dangerous situation because he's cut of the b file, he's cut of the third rank, so he doesn't have a lot of squares. Now knight d3 was played to consolidate the position. But here simply black are starting to push the pawns, so they are playing a5. And this pawn actually runs very fast, and with the king is cut on the b file, it's not so simple to stop the a pawn. White have tried to improve their rook, but now it allows the black rook to come to the e file, so now he's attacking the bishop, and also he wants to go to e4. Here white have gave this check on f7, the king wants to b8, and now rook e7 was played to defend the bishop, but still white in trouble because after rook e4 they can lose the h pawn. But instead this first Karpov decided to play the move rook b5, because he wants to stop the possible knight c5 idea, and this pawn will not escape. And now he also wants to push the a pawn, and in this position Adams decided to resign because there are no useful moves with the knight and with the bishop, of course, and with the king. If you give this check, black will simply play king a7, and he will lose probably the h pawn, so then black has too many pawns. Now let's see some more recent example. This time we are going to see a game between Wang Yang and Shahryar Mamadyarov, which was played in 2015. And again the opening was Trompowsky. Bishop g5, g6, bishop f6. And we have this pawn structure with double pawns, which we were talking about in our preview. Now white are playing c4, so they don't want to allow d5, so easy. Bishop g7, knight c3, and castle was played. And here after g3, instead of playing this plan which I told you, d6 and f5, and then try to bring the knight on f6, Mamadyarov decided to play immediately the move c5. And this move is now very sharp. The main idea, of course, is to open this diagonal for the bishop, so in case of d5 and then f5, then this is something like Benoni, but one very good version for black, because white don't have this bishop on c1. That's why, maybe, white decided here to take on c5, which is the other option. Of course, they're winning the pawn. And now, black are playing the move f5 again. Bishop g2 was played, and now the knight has developed to knight 6, and he wants to take the pawn on c5, and for white it's impossible to keep this pawn on c5, because black can also bring the queen to attack this pawn in case of move like queen d5. That's why white preferred to develop their knight, but not on f3, but they found an interesting idea to play the move knight h3. This move might seem a little bit odd in the first place, but actually this knight wants to go now after knight c5 to f4 and then to d5. So if you put the knight on f3, it will close the diagonal for the bishop, although this is still, of course, good move, but maybe white thought that the knight on f4 will be better than the knight on f3, and it has some logic, because he can jump on d5. But first here, white decided to play the move rook c1. I don't know, maybe they were afraid that suddenly black can take on c3 and double their pawn on the c-file, so they prefer to play the move rook c1. And now they want to play knight f4, also they want to play maybe at some moment the pawn to b4 to attack this knight. So it looks that white have actually good position. But now Mamadyarov has found a very good move, knight e4. What is the idea of this move? Of course the idea is to take this knight and also attack the pawn on b2 if this knight moves somewhere, let's say to d5, or if white takes here. Black will take, and now the pawn on b2 is attacked. If white play b3, black can maybe even play queen f5 check. And if you take the pawn on e4, of course black can take on b2, but maybe even they can play First the move d5, which attacks both these pieces, and then in case of bishop g2, they can take on b2 or on c4, and they have a very good position because the bishop is much stronger than the knight on h3 now. Here white preferred to castle instead, but this allowed, of course, black to capture on c3, and now white have this double pawns on the c file. From the other hand, now it's time for black to develop, and it's not so simple to develop this bishop on c8, because he has to defend on b7. But black has found a way by playing the move queen c7 first, to attack the c4 pawn. Now white have developed the queen to d3, and now d6 was played with the idea to play bishop e6, knight f4, bishop e6, and here white has to take decision what to do. They can take on e6, or they can play knight d5. But after knight d5, black are not forced to take on d5. They can play the queen somewhere, maybe queen on a5 or queen on c5, and then they can prepare the move rook c8. Not immediately, maybe, because there will be knight e7 check, but eventually they will bring the rooks in the c-file, and again this pawn could be weak on c4, and although this knight is very strong on d5, he actually cannot go anywhere, because then the bishop will take on c4. Maybe that's why white decided to take on e6, to simplify the position, and now after the move rook b1, it looks that the position should be equal, because there are this opposite colored bishop, and the white bishop on g2 is quite active, especially with the combination of the rook to b1. And now black has to defend the pawn on b7, and they have only one move, rook b8. And after rook d1, white has activated the other rook. And now in case of rook d8, maybe they have also this idea to play at some moment queen e3 and attack both pawns on e6 and a7, and when you take on c4 to take on a7, and then maybe on b7, so this way they will get rid of this double pawn. But actually Mamedyarov decided not to defend this pawn on d6, but immediately to play the pawn to b6, to sacrifice the pawn on d6. And white has to take this pawn, because otherwise if they don't take it, slowly black will defend their pawn on d6, and again now they can move the other rook, which has to defend so far the pawn on b7. He was released, so they can play rook d8, rook c8, and white are going to lose maybe this pawn anyway. So of course it's much better to take the pawn on d6 in exchange. Queen takes c4, and now the queen from c4 is attacking three white pawns, but white here thought that with the move queen f4 they can defend a couple of them, and also they are attacking the pawn on a7. So the position here looks actually maybe equal. Now queen e2 was played, and here instead of taking the pawn on a7, which could allow maybe bishop takes c3, and white decided to play here first the move rook d7. Because they have some now threats, for example, maybe they want to play queen e7 and suddenly to start attack in the endgame. And also, of course, they're attacking the pawn on a7. Now they're keeping their both pawns. So the question is, if black are going to keep the pawn on a7, or they're going to let white to take the pawn and maybe equalize. Mamedyarov decided to play a5, which looks a bit risky, because now queen 7 is allowed, but there is defense after queen 7, and this is the move queen e5. So with this move, black managed to keep the extra pawn on e6, and they defending the checkmate. Now rook b5 was played. Of course, you cannot take the rook on b5, because queen g7 is a checkmate, but black can play queen f6, and now this end game. After rook d6, again it looks that white can make maybe a draw, because they are going to take one of the pawns. But now after king f7, Mamedyarov decided that it's better to keep the pawn on e6, and after rook takes, Again he takes the pawn on c3, keeping his extra pawn. Rook b7 was played. And here king f6. This is also a very typical move. Sometimes black prefer to sacrifice the pawn on h7, so they can have an active king in exchange. Otherwise, if you put the king on g8, he will be cut off until the end of the game. And now, actually, it turns out that after rook h7, the position looks like a complete draw, but after the move rook c8, suddenly now black have very good threats, which are bishop d4, and then to bring the rook to c2, this will attack both pawns on a2 and f2. With the move bishop b7, white tried to stop this idea, but after rook c5, again the plan is bishop d4, a4 was played now, and here after the move rook c4, white have decided to resign, which looks maybe a bit premature, but they are going to lose the a-pawn, and again the bishop will go to d4, and most likely the rook will go to a2, so they are going to have problems with the f-pawn, so the Chinese player here decided to resign. Our final game in this chapter is going to be between Sergei Zhigalko and Ivan Cheparinov, which is quite recent, from 2018. And she was played in this London system, in one of the lines which I have showed to you, bishop e2 d6, and now h3, like I said, to avoid knight h5, b6 was played. So this is one of the most popular setups for black. a4 was played this time, not c3. a4 is not so common move, but again the thing can transpose very easy. c5 was played, c3, and after a6 we're seeing actually one of the positions which I have shown to you in our preview. And here white has played the move rook e1, which of course is a useful move. He has two options now, to support maybe the move e4 in case you bring the bishop to d3 or f1, and also in case of c takes pawn ad, to open the e-pawn for e-file for the rook. But Cheparinov was not afraid of this. He took on d4. Now white has to make a decision with which pawn they have to take. They can take actually with both pawns, only not with the knight, of course, because in case of knight takes e5, white lose immediately, but e takes looks more natural. But now black have this idea, knight d5. And after the bishop retreats, they go the bishop to h6. This way they are taking this diagonal, and they want to prepare maybe the move knight f4. Now white are playing the move bishop d3, which of course is looks natural, and now maybe they want to bring the bishop to e4, and they are opening the e-file for the rook. The other knight goes to f6, now knight e4. And here in case of knight takes e4, bishop takes e4, it will be good for white. So maybe the idea of black was to play here knight h5, which they did. And now they want to jump on f4. So here white have decided to play the move bishop f1. But it allows, actually it allows black to play the move knight e3, which is very interesting. Of course, this move is not winning anything, because after pawn takes, bishop takes, again the material is equal, but it has moved actually the pawn from f2 to e3, and this is a bit devilish. From one hand, it exposed a little bit the position of the white king, but from the other hand, if white can push the pawn to e4 and e5, this pawn could be much stronger than the pawn on f2. Now bishop d3 was played again, so it's interesting how this bishop goes from d3 to f1 and then goes back. And black wants to eliminate this bishop, which not allowing their pawn to go forward. Now black has to play knight f6. And after this trade, again, white offering another trade, and again with this idea, to play e4, so black has to take on d2, they don't have any other better options. Queen d2, and we have this position which looks like an equal position, of course. And here it's time to black to play something. And Chebarnov has played a very useful move, b5. And this way he wants to set up his pawns on the light squares, because he has a dark square bishop. Also, he is stopping the possible c4, and maybe there is now a square for the queen to go to b6, which looks like a good square. Queen d3 was played, but here instead of queen b6, Chebarnov decided to go queen d7. And after pawn takes, white finally has pushed the pawn to e6, which was their goal. Now they have a very good position, but after queen c6, black also don't have problems, because they don't have any weakness. And they're battling for the a-file. For the moment it looks that nobody will control the a-file. But now white has taken a very interesting decision to play the move d5, which is in general good, because they also want to push the pawns to the light squares, because they have this dark square bishop. Queen c5 was played, check, king goes to h1, and now bishop goes back to g7, because now black wants to play the move b4 and put some pressure on these pawns. And also the bishop wants to stop the possible e5. Now white has to activate their bishop, so they are also playing bishop g1. And they want to go bishop d4 in case of black goes somewhere back. Not only white can take this pawn on b5, but they have this idea bishop d4. Of course here queen c4 is the best move for black. And now after queen takes, pawn takes, again, the pawn structure has changed a little bit, and this is good for black overall, because when the pawn moves on c4, she blocks the pawn on b2. So now black wants to play the move rook b8. So I think this idea with d5 and queen takes c4 was not so good for white, because now the pawn on b2 can be exposed. And here they have played a little bit strange move, bishop a7. Which reminds us, of course, to the classical game of Anatoly Karpov, who was played back in the 70s, I think, against Ullmann. In the middle game, he made this move bishop a7 with the idea to double the rooks. Here, this move is more maybe defensive, because he wants to stop rook b8, but actually, black can simply go to b7 instead, so they're moving the rook to c8 with the threat rook c7, and then he can go to b7. And now white has some problems with the pawn on b2. They have played the move rook a2. So in case of rook c7, they wanted to double the rooks on the a-file. But now simply Chebarnov has played this move to b8. And after rook a1, he saw this interesting combination. Rook takes b2. And now the game becomes very interesting. Rook takes b2, bishop takes c3. White has to play rook b1, now bishop takes, rook takes, and in exchange for the piece, black have only two pawns, and if they move something now, some of the pawns, let's say h5 or e6 or something like this, white will simply play bishop d4 and they will have winning position. But of course Chebarnov saw something more, which was the move c3. Now this move c3 is closing the diagonal, so bishop d4 is not possible. And now also, black wants to play the pawn to c2. And then they will win actually the piece back, because the rook has to defend the bishop, but he also has to defend the pawn to be promoted. So now the threat is to play c2. And white actually don't have any defense, because if they move the bishop, they lose the rook. If they move the rook, they lose the bishop. So they have played g4. And now after c2, they have to take this pawn on c2, but here black have extra pawn, and also white have this weak pawn on e4. Rook a3 was played to cut the white king, and now the rook goes to e3, also very good move. Now the white rook is forced to come into this defensive position, and now actually both white, the rook and the king, they have to defend their weak pawns. And this allows, after this very good move g5, The black king now is ready to enter here. The idea of the move g5 is of course to stop the possible h4 move. So now this pawn will stay here forever on h3. And now white can simply wait, and black is starting to improve their position slowly. And after a few moves, they simply won this endgame very, very easy. d5, white have played a few more moves, but in general, this is completely lost position. And here, finally, Chiparinov has won the game. So I hope you have enjoyed this first chapter. We have seen here a few opportunities how to play against these setups in Trompowsky and in the London system. And I think overall black have different replies, but most of the replies for black are very good, and they don't have problems in this setup. So I hope you have enjoyed this, and see you next time.